Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you very much for the privilege you have granted us to gather together again. Thank you for your Spirit that is always teaching us, taking these words and making us victorious in our lives. As we come to the study today, the last part of the last chapter of Hebrews, we're asking, O Lord, you open our eyes of understanding, that we may see the great things you have preserved for us in your word, in Jesus' name. We pray that you keep us awake, make us attentive, and let this word bear fruit in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Be glorified in our lives, and let the product of this word in our lives bring honor and glory to you in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 13 today, and we're studying the last four verses, verses 22 to 25. Hebrews chapter 13, from verse 22. And I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation, for I have written a letter unto you in few words. Know ye that our brother Timothy is set at liberty, with whom, if he come shortly, I will see you. Salute all them that have the rule over you, and all the saints, they of Italy, salute you. Grace be with you all. Amen. As you see, we are reading and studying the closing verses of the epistle to the Hebrews today. I don't know, whenever you receive a letter, you read that letter, and then if the person says, yours faithfully, so and so, then he puts a P.S. And the P.S. means a postscript. That means he just remembered something that he wants to put there, and then he writes that thing. Maybe he just simply says, please don't forget to help me pass such and such a message to so and so. And most people will not take the postscript very serious because it's tied to the tail of the letter. Many people do that with the word of God. They will read the most part of the word in an epistle like this, epistle to the Hebrews. They will start from chapter 1 and go on to chapter 13. And by the time they come to verse 21, they feel that the meat of the word, the great thing of the word, the teaching of the word, the real basic doctrine has been given. And all that remains now is just to them a postscript. And therefore they may read and they just pass over without much attention and without serious study. The attitude seems to say that the Holy Spirit has now stopped in verse 21. He has withdrawn his inspiration, and therefore all that remains has nothing to do with the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. But that is an erroneous attitude, because the Bible says all scripture, together with the closing verses of this epistle, is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, and for reproof, and for correction, and for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. These verses, therefore, are worthy of a serious study and close consideration. Now you will notice that in the previous verse that we studied, Paul the apostle had been speaking to the people. And as we look from chapter 1 to this chapter, he had actually given a lot of commandments, a lot of instructions. As he now comes to the end and he was rounding up, he told them, he said, I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation. That is, the admonition, the teaching, the instruction, the doctrine he had given unto them. He wanted them to have receptive minds and willing hearts, that they will receive everything he had given unto them. He himself knew that in the last days, perilous time shall come. And one of the things that will happen in the last days is that men will not endure sound doctrine, but they will heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. They'll prefer fables to the truth. Therefore he told them, he said, brethren, do you see the truth, deep truth, the mysteries of the kingdom of God I've given you in this epistle. He said, suffer that word of exhortation. And then he reminded them that Timothy had now been released from the prison. He was being persecuted. And he wanted them that they would be expecting both himself and Timothy will be coming unto them. He was telling them that although the epistle was coming to an end, fellowship has not come to an end. Ministry has not come to an end. And teaching has not come to an end. Obedience to the word of God will still continue. The same thing I want to remind you, although we're coming to the end of the epistle to the Hebrews, Bible study has not come to an end. By the grace of God, we'll be here next Monday in Jesus' name. And we'll be starting a new book, and it will be an interesting book. We'll introduce the book when we come next week, and get ready, come with your whole mind and your whole heart. The Lord will reveal much more to us in Jesus' name. Now today, as we're looking at this closing exhortation and benediction, we'll be dividing into three parts. Number one is the word of exhortation. The word of exhortation. Number two, a worker in need of encouragement. And in number three, as you can expect, the subtitle number three is Welcome to the End. Now number one, we're looking at the word of exhortation. Let's look at verse 22. It said, I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation. For I have written a letter unto you in few words. It's very important whenever we are reading the word of God, studying the word of God, you make a connection between what you are reading now and what had been written in the previous verse. Do you remember what we studied the other time in our last study? Verses 20 and 21. Now, the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, who through the blood of the everlasting covenant make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. You will see that in those two verses, he was talking about the divine operation in the hearts of the people. He was asking that the God of peace himself will do something in them, will perform an operation in them and make them perfect. Make them perfect in every good work to do the will of the Father, working in them by supernatural power to do that which was well pleasing in the sight of the Lord. Do you realize in verse 22, it's not telling us the human part. Verse 21 is the divine part. It's a divine operation. It's a work of grace. It's the power of God working in the believer. But now verse 22 is the responsibility of the believer himself. You see, Paul the apostle was a wise master builder. And as a teacher, he will talk on the divine part, and immediately he'll talk on the human part. And whenever you are reading the word of God, you need to understand God has his part to play. But then we ourselves, we have our part to play. That is the balanced truth in the approach to teaching. Divine operation in us must be followed by decided obedience by us. What was he calling them to? In verse 22, and I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation. To start with, what did he mean by the word of exhortation? Let's come to Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 13, verse 15. Here we will find what it means when it says the word of exhortation. And after the reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent unto them, saying, men and brethren, if ye have any word of exhortation, the same kind of a clause, it says, if you have any word of exhortation, It says, for the people, say on. Then Paul stood up and beckoning with his hand said, men and brethren, ye that fear God, give audience. And then he began to preach. Here there was a service. And as usual, Paul the apostle will go into the synagogue. In verse 14, he had gone into the synagogue. And the worship had been going on. They had done the singing. They had even done the Bible reading. They read from the book of the law and they read from the prophets. Now they needed a message from God. And therefore they called unto Paul. They said, if you have any word of exhortation, say on. What is a word of exhortation then? It's a message coming directly through the apostle or through the preacher unto the audience. As we come back to Hebrews chapter 13 verse 22. I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation. From chapter 1 all through to this point, you will see that many instructions had been given in the epistle. Many commandments had been given by the apostle, and it was a message from the Lord. And the apostle was now saying, give attention to that precept. Give attention to that commandment. Give attention to those words that you have heard as you have gone through the epistle. Although you have read it and we have studied it, let me just go through by way of remembrance, by way of reminding you the exhortation, the instruction, the precepts, the word of exhortation he was reminding them of. In Hebrews chapter 2 verse 1. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 1. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard, lest at any time we should let them sleep. That's the same thing he was still saying. We have heard, we have learned, we have studied. They should make impact in our lives. We ought to give them more earnest heed to those things which we have heard. Chapter 3 verse 12. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. He was telling them they should be soft in their heart, receptive in their heart, and they should be willing to take the word of God at face value and be obedient to the word of God, and they should not allow the spirit of the age, the hardening of the heart, the deception or deceivableness of sin or iniquity affect them. That's what he was reminding them of when he said, I beseech you, brethren, that you will suffer, that you will endure, that you will embrace the word of exhortation. Chapter 4 verse 1, let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. He was reminding them, there is a rest now for the people of God, and there are conditions to be fulfilled, and I've given you those conditions, and you have seen those exhortations, therefore you will suffer, you will permit, you will allow, you will accept that word of exhortation. Don't stay behind, move on. And then in verse 11 of that same chapter 4, let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall or fail after the same example of unbelief. In chapter 6 verse 11, the word of exhortation that he was reminding them. Chapter 6 verse 11, and we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end. He was telling them, this is the exhortation he was reminding them of, and he said you should suffer, you should permit and embrace that word of exhortation. You keep on in a diligent manner with full assurance to the very end of time, that ye be not slothful, in verse 12, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. It's just not just a one moment experience, a one time event. You'll be following on and following on patiently and perseveringly until you are going to inherit the blessing. In chapter 10 of Hebrews from verse 22, let us draw near. This is the exhortation. Suffer the word of exhortation. Accept the word of exhortation. Embrace the word of exhortation. Apply the word of exhortation. Assimilate that word of exhortation and be obedient to the word of exhortation. Verse 22, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure blood. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting, encouraging one another, as so much the more as he see the day approaching. This is what he was reminding them of. He said, in the epistle that I've written to you, you've seen there were many exhortations. You have seen there were many admonitions. You have seen the teaching and the instructions. Suffer that watch of exhortation and keep on obeying them. Even though we are closing the epistle now, even though we are concluding the epistle now, remember those instructions because they're good for your life, and obey those instructions because that is indispensable for escaping the wrath of God and getting to heaven eventually. In verse 35, cast not away therefore your confidence, which has great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. He was reminding them that they should also be patient and persevering. Chapter 12 of Hebrews, verses 1 and 2. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. You will see that in all these things that we are reading, we are reminding ourselves of the exhortation. We are reminding ourselves of the things he had said in the epistle, which he himself was bringing back now to their memory, saying that you remember that exhortation, suffer that word of exhortation. In chapter 12 verse 14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Let's come back to chapter 13 now. In Hebrews chapter 13, reading from verse 22. And I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation. You've seen what the exhortation means, what the instruction means, what commandments they had given to them, and he wanted them to recall that, and he said, suffer it. Why did he use that strong word, suffer it? It was like he was saying, endure it. What did he say, endure it? He was saying, it may run contrary to your own sentiments, and it may run contrary to your old ideas and prejudices, because your eternal destiny depends upon receiving it. You must endure it. You must suffer it. You know, sometimes the word of God will be very pointed, and it will be crossing our will, opposing our tradition, opposing our preferences. But then it's telling us, leave all those preferences aside, leave your own personal will aside, and suffer the word of exhortation. Allow the word of exhortation. Sometimes it comes like a sword. Sometimes it comes like a military kind of decree. Sometimes it comes with sharpness. But you must endure that word of exhortation. But look at the language in verse 22. And I beseech you. He could have been speaking like an apostle with authority, but he said, I could have spoken like an apostle with authority, but because of love, I beseech you. Philemon, just before Hebrews, Philemon, verses 8 and 9. Wherefore, though I might be much bold in Christ to enjoin thee that which is convenient, yet for love's sake I rather beseech thee. He was saying, I'm pleading with you. It's a word of affection. It's a word of love. He said, I set aside my authority as an apostle, and instead of using that authority as an apostle, I just beseech you, I plead with you, I'm begging of you that you will take the word of exhortation very seriously. And he said, I beseech you, brethren. He was talking to them as brethren. as children of God, as the people that are partakers of the heavenly calling, the people that have the grace of God in their lives. And because the grace of God was there, he told them, you have the ability to endure, you have the ability to suffer it, you have the ability to receive it, receive it. And then in verse 22, for I have written a letter unto you in few words. That may surprise you, and it may come to you as strange. How can you say that this is few? We've been 52 weeks on this thing, and we've been studying for a long time, and the apostle says, do you see the epistle I've written to you? Do you see that letter I've written to you? Just in a few words. You know why he said that? He said, if you will compare the weighty subjects in the epistle, if you will compare the eternal realities in the epistle, if you will compare all the things I've been talking about, the old covenant and the new covenant, and I've spoken about Moses, and I've spoken about Aaron, and I've spoken about the old covenant and the old sacrifices and the old offerings, I've spoken about all that, just in 13 chapters, those things could have taken volumes. It could have been a compendium that will just pile up, because he was talking about eternal mysteries. Therefore, he said, in comparison with the deep, in comparison with the great, in comparison with the high things I have dealt with, these are just few words I have written unto you. And he said, although they are few, you must be obedient unto them. I pray God will give us the grace to be obedient to his word in Jesus' name. Now we go to point two, a worker in need of encouragement. We come to verse 23. It says, know ye that our brother Timothy is set at liberty, with whom, if he come shortly, I will see you. As you look at this verse, you understand that this Timothy was talking about a co-laborer, a fellow servant of the Lord. He had been going through persecution. Actually, the apostle had written to him, and the apostle had prepared his mind that persecution may come, difficulty may come, and because of the temperament of Timothy, he was telling them he should not forsake the Lord. He should hold on to the Lord. We learn something from this. When Timothy was accepting that word or receiving that word from Paul the apostle, he didn't know that the persecution he will receive may even lead to imprisonment, but the word he had received in 2 Timothy chapter 1 prepared him. And before we come to the Hebrews, the end of Hebrews, he had gone into imprisonment for suffering for the gospel, but by the grace of God he had also been delivered and released. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1 from verse 4. Greatly desiring to see thee, be mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. But says, wherefore I put thee to remembrance, that thou stirrest up the gift of God, which is in thee, by putting on of my hands. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, and of love, and of a sound mind. Verse 8, be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me as prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. That's what prepared him. He had received the word, and the apostle had told him, you must not be ashamed. It's my turn now. I'm going through the persecution now. You must not be ashamed of me or ashamed of the testimony of the Lord, even though I'm a prisoner at that time. And even you yourself, you must be prepared to be a partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. You know, sometimes when you are hearing the word of God, you do not know what that word of God is preparing you for. That's why it is good we come every Monday, and we come on Thursday in our districts, and then we come on Sunday in our district. You see, when you are receiving that word of God, is doing something in you, so that when an event will come, when persecution will come, when suffering will come, what you have received will be producing steadfastness and strength in you. And so as we come to Hebrews chapter 13 and in verse 23, we're not being given the information, know ye that our brother Timothy is now set at liberty. He has not been released from the prison, which tells us again, answer to the prayer of Paul the Apostle, because Paul the Apostle said, I'm mindful of your tears, I'm mindful of your difficulties, and I'm praying for you. And as a result of the prayers of the people of God, he was even delivered from the prison. But Paul the Apostle said, I've not seen him yet, with whom if he comes shortly. I've got the information myself, but we have not seen face to face. When he comes shortly, we will come unto you. Which tells us again that even after coming out of that imprisonment, after coming out of that difficulty, the ministry will not stop. They will still both continue serving the Lord and ministering the gospel. Let's learn a little about this Timothy. As we look at the word of God, we see that actually Timothy needed encouragement. You know why? Because emotionally, he needed encouragement. Not only that, he was a man of frail constitution. He wasn't very strong physically. He wasn't very healthy. And we get that from 1 Timothy chapter 5. 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 23. Looking at the physical condition of Timothy. Drink no longer wine, but use a little wine. Drink no longer water, but use a little wine for thy stomach's sake and thine often infirmities. He was being told here, don't drink the ordinary water in Asia Minor. Because already you have frail constitution. You are not very strong. You are not very healthy. And if you drink the water ordinarily, it's going to make your condition worse. You know what you are going to do? You are going to use some wine. Use it like medicine. And put it in the water. So that the water will become purer. And then you will drink that. Why am I considering you like that, Timothy? Because of your stomach. Your stomach sick. Was it ulcer he had? Or whatever other problem in his intestine, and also your frequent sicknesses, your frequent infirmities, often infirmities. And you will see that a person like that with frail constitution and with failing health, he actually needed encouragement. And Paul the Apostle told the Corinthian believers about Timothy. He told them that this man needs encouragement. When he comes to you, make sure that you encourage him because of his weaknesses in 1 Corinthians chapter 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 16 verse 10. Now, if Timotheus comes, see that he may be with you without fear, for he walketh the work of the Lord as I also do. He said, Timothy is very, very sensitive. Therefore, when he comes to you, make sure that you do all things to support him, and to accept him, and to encourage him, and to receive his word, because actually we're doing the same work of God. He's not as strong as I am. Paul was saying physically, he cannot endure physical inconvenience like I can, but when he comes, let him be with you without fear. And in verse 11, let no man therefore despise him. You see his attitude, you see his temperament, you see his frailty, you see his failing health. Don't despise him because of that, but conduct him forth in peace, that he may come unto me, for I look for him with the brethren. And even though he was weak like that, yet he was a faithful man. It's a wonderful thing when you find somebody who is not very strong physically, not very strong emotionally, who can easily be disturbed psychologically, and yet in his faith, he was very strong. Which tells us that what a person is in the physical is not necessarily his condition in the spiritual. He may be weak physically, but strong spiritually. He may be weak emotionally, but he may be strong in the Lord. And the epistle to the Philippians helps us to know a little about his faithfulness. about your spiritual strength. And as you look at Philippians chapter 2, Philippians chapter 2 from verse 19, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort, that I may know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. He was caring. He was loving. And he was concerned for the people at Philippi. And Paul the apostle was saying, when I think about the people that are faithful, about people that are dependable, about people I can trust, there is nobody I can compare to this Timothy. And then he said, for all seek their own, not the things of Jesus Christ. The others are self-willed. The others are thinking about themselves. The others are thinking of what they can gain and what they can get out of the service of the Lord. But in verse 22, ye know the proof of him, that as a son with the father, he has served with me in the gospel. What a great testimonial Paul the apostle had for this man, for Timothy. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17, he gives us a further credential concerning this Timothy, his faithfulness and his loyalty and his love for the things of the Lord, and his dependability. Look at it in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. For this cause have I sent to you Timotheus, who is my beloved son, faithful in the Lord, who shall bring you into remembrance of my ways, which be in Christ, as I teach everywhere in every church. He sent Timothy to them, and he said, he'll come to you. And when he comes to you, he will make you to know everything that we have been doing here. And he will tell you everything about me, because he knows everything about me. He's been walking as a son with the father. It was this Timothy that had been in prison. And it was this Timothy that had now come out of the prison. We're back in Hebrews chapter 13, and in verse 23, know ye that our brother, not just my brother, is our brother, is useful to me, is useful to you. He has made himself available for the whole church. He is our brother Timothy. He is set at liberty now as a result of my prayers, as a result of your prayers, because we have really been wondering about him, how he will be able to get through because of his frailty and because of his weakness. The Lord has answered our prayers. The Lord has set him free. He's no more in the prison. I'm still to see him, with whom, if he comes shortly, I will see you. We learn something here. He said, I'm not going to allow him to go and minister now alone. He has just come out. I want to be with him now. I want to be by his side now. I want to be supporting him now. And we're going to come together now. You see, Paul the apostle could go to the Hebrews all alone, because he was very strong, and he didn't want to send Timothy now alone. He has just gone through all the difficulty of the imprisonment. He didn't say, I will send him to you. He said, no, I'm not going to allow him to travel alone now. I'm going to come with him, supporting him, and we're going to come together and minister unto you. There's another thing we learn here. Paul the apostle is just concluding the epistle he was writing to them. He was teaching them by writing. But now he said, I'm going to come and do the follow-up. Already you have got the ministry, and I've taught you deep things and great things about the Lord in this epistle. You are reading the epistle. Maybe before you finish reading the epistle, I'll be there myself with Timothy to follow up on what I've taught you already, and then we'll be teaching you together and ministering to you together. He believed in follow-up by precept and by practice. He was going to do what he was preaching. And what an example for us too, that as we are preaching the word of God and we're sending the word of God to the people in need, we will follow up as well. And they're wonderful that our retreats are just finished a few weeks ago. We should not forget, a lot had been done during the retreat, but the follow-up should still continue, and we should make sure that we're doing it in partnership with other people that love the Lord. And then he was saying that actually a person like this needs encouragement. Actually, all who labor faithfully, all who serve tirelessly, all who work faithfully, all who evangelize and edify the church, ministering to the needs of other people, they need our encouragement, and I pray that God will help us. We'll be encouraging one another in Jesus' name. Now we come back to Hebrews chapter 13, verse 24, and in verse 25, salute all that have the rule over you, and all the saints, they of Italy salute you. Grace be with you all. Amen. Now I title this section, Welcome to the End. And it's an encouraging thing. Do you know now this is lesson or study number 52. It's taking us a long, long time to finish the epistle. But I learned a lesson from this. No matter how long a journey might be, no matter how difficult a task might be, sooner or later, you will come to the end. Just a step at a time. Just a portion at a time. And eventually, you will come to an end. We can ask the question, were you to eat an elephant as big as an elephant is, how can you finish eating an elephant? Very simple, just a bite at a time. And I want to encourage you in your own life. You may have a difficult task, you may have a responsibility, you may have something you want to do. You look at it as something very long, something very big, and something very difficult. And you say, when will I ever finish this? Just get started. And just 2 verses at a time, 3 verses at a time, a portion at a time, a step at a time, a bite at a time, eventually you will come to the end in Jesus' name. But that's also an illustration about life itself. Sometimes life looks very, very long, but eventually, as we live a moment at a time, a day at a time, a week at a time, don't think about tomorrow. Leave that in the hands of God. Don't think about the past. Leave that in the hands of God, since God has forgiven the past. Live today the way you should live today, and just living a day at a time like that, a day at a time like that, you will come to the successful end of your life's journey in Jesus' name. And you know, sometimes when you are sick, it appears that the sickness will never end. It appears this is too much, how can I bear? Just have the grace to bear it now, and bear it the next moment, and bear it the next minute. You will find eventually you will come to the end of the sickness. Everything will be over in Jesus' name. That's why the Lord is encouraging us in Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, reading from verse 13. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. How do I endure to the end? Don't think about all the difficulties you are going to have, all the persecutions you are going to have, all the trauma or the suffering you are going to have. The little bit you have today, endure that. The little bit you have tomorrow, endure that. The little bit you are going to endure another time, endure that. And a little at a time, a little at a time, you will come to a glorious end in Jesus' name. In 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 7. 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 7, the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. And so you will see that eventually, sooner or later, everything down here on earth will come to an end. The message is, don't be tired, be consistent, don't give up. A step now, another step after, another step after, and you'll come to the end. Now in verse 24, salute all them that have the rule over you. Here I was asking that there should be a good relationship between the congregation and the leadership of the congregation. He said the members of the congregation, they should take care of their leaders, and they should love their leaders, they should honor their leaders, be affectionate towards their leaders, and the least way in which we can show that affection and show that love is at least to be able to greet them, to be able to say how are you, and to be praying for them, and to wish them well. And then he said, don't only do that to the ministers and to the leaders, you should greet all the saints as well. We make sure that we don't live like strangers among ourselves. You are a child of God, I'm a child of God, we're children of God. Let us feel at home with one another, let us love one another, let us not be lacking in the social kind of responsibilities. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. How are you? How is your family? Is everything going on fine? Let us ask of one another's welfare. In fact, he said even the Christians in Italy, they are also sending greetings unto you. And after he had said that, now he said, grace be with you all. And isn't it a wonderful way to end the epistle? That's how we start our Christian lives. That's how we continue with our Christian lives. And that is how we're going to end our Christian life. The grace of the Lord be with you. The question is, what does the grace of God do in our lives? Let's look at the scriptures and see what the grace of God does in our lives. And let us see that we need the grace of God every time in Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, verse 24. And being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. That's where we begin. When you are going to live the Christian life, you want to come into Christ, it's not by marriage, it's not by power, and it is not by might. It is not by the works of righteousness which you have done. We start the Christian race and the Christian life by the grace of God. And that grace of God is available to everyone. In fact, we have always explained that word grace as God's riches at Christ's expense. It is God's righteousness at Christ's expense. And it is God's redemption at Christ's expense. It's available for you, it's available for me, and for those who are still outside the kingdom of God. You can come in. It doesn't require money. It doesn't require your human effort. It doesn't require any power. It doesn't require any personal ability. It is by the grace of God we are justified, we are forgiven, we are saved, we are adopted into the family of God just by the grace of God. And as you come into the family of God, by the grace of God, you find that this grace continues to increase in your life, and it becomes so abundant that the grace of God is abundant. In fact, you begin to reign in life by that grace of God. In Romans chapter 5, Romans chapter 5, verse 17, for if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive the abundance of grace. That's what the Lord is calling you into. You will find as you come into the Christian life, the grace of God will never dry up. The grace of God will never finish. Whatever step you want to take, whatever need may be in your life, the grace will be available, because it says there is a grace, the abundance of grace, and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, even Jesus Christ. In verse 21, that as sin has reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. That means you can really have dominion in life, you can have victory in life, you can reign in life, you can be an overcomer in life. The grace that brought you in is the grace that makes you stand, and it is in that grace you will be reigning. And then it tells us, as you want to serve God, it is still that grace of God that helps you and keeps you in serving the Lord. In Hebrews chapter 12, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28. Hebrews 12, 28. Wherefore, we receive in a kingdom which cannot be moved. Let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Do you see what grace does in our lives? Do you see why the apostles were always telling the believers, grace and peace be multiplied unto you? Do you see why they were always ending the epistles by saying, grace be to the believers? You get saved through that grace, and you stand in that grace, and you continue to reign in life, having dominion and victory through that grace. And even in serving the Lord, you receive grace whereby you'll be able to serve God acceptably with reverence and with godly fear. In fact, it is that grace that makes you to be established in the faith, established in the things of the Lord. In Hebrews chapter 13 and in verse 9, Hebrews chapter 13 verse 9, be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace. How are you going to be established? Are you going to be settled? Are you going to be grounded? Are you going to be solid? Are you going to be matured? It is by that same grace of God. You find out then, while the apostles were always talking about the grace of God, the grace of God, the grace of God, every time. And then you can come to the throne of grace in Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16, it says, let us therefore. Why did he say therefore? Because we need the grace. Because it's by that we're saved. Because it's through that we're standing. It's through that we're reigning in life. It's through that we're overcomers in life. It is through that we're able to serve God acceptably. And it is through that we're able to get established and firm and solid and steadfast. Therefore, let us come boldly unto the throne of grace. It is not Sinai, it is Zion. And it is not the throne of judgment, it is the throne of grace. And it says that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Whatever need you may come across in your life, the grace of God is there. It reminds us of Paul the apostle when he had a thorn in the flesh, and he said it was a messenger of the devil, and he said it was buffeting him, until he went to the Lord and said, oh Lord, take this sin away from me. And then the Lord gave him a wonderful word, which the Lord is giving to every one of us in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and in verse 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 verse 9. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. In what condition do you find yourself today? What difficulty do you have today? Is there a thorn in the flesh? Is there a difficulty in your way? Is there a mountain to climb? Is there a task, a duty too much for you, and you almost are giving up? Why don't you come boldly to the throne of grace and receive help in the time of need? My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Even though you are weak now, the grace of God will come to your life. You will be strong in Jesus' name. Most gladly, therefore, I will rather glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest on me. How much grace is the Lord willing to give you? Look at it in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you. All grace, no matter your situation, no matter your circumstance, no matter your need, he is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye always, having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. Do you see what the grace of God does? It goes beyond just salvation. It goes beyond sanctification. It keeps us in life, and then it tells us there is all grace, and there is always, there is all sufficiency in all things, and every good work. And then as we come to a conclusion, you look at Psalm 84. In Psalm 84, it tells us grace is in the company of goodness and glory. That when you come to the Lord and you have that grace of God in your life, see what accompanies the grace of God in Psalm 84 and in verse 11. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. The Lord will give you more of his grace. The abundance of the grace of God he will give unto you in Jesus' name. My beloved, grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt, yonder on Calvary's Mount outpoured there, where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Then it says, sin and despair, like the sea waves cold, threaten the soul with infinite loss. But grace, yes, grace that is greater, grace untold, points to the refuge, the mighty cross. Marvelous grace, infinite grace, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see his faith, will you at this moment his grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within, grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sins, all our problems, all our difficulties, that grace available for you here today. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let's rise up and pray and ask the Lord for that grace. We need grace to obey the Lord. We need grace to follow the Lord. We need grace to do everything the Lord wants us to do. We need grace to overcome our difficulties. We need grace to have dominion in life. We need grace to overcome in life. We need grace to march like a triumphant believer in life. And the Lord is willing to give you that grace even now. The grace of the Lord is available. It says, my grace is sufficient for you. To be able to obey the word of exhortation, to obey all that the Lord has revealed to us in the epistle to the Hebrews, and all that we have learned today, we need the grace of God. I need the grace of God, you need the grace of God. All that we have learned in all these 52 studies, we need the grace of God to be able to obey them. And then to care for other people, to love other people, to encourage other people, to rejoice with them that are rejoicing, to weep with them that are weeping, to put yourself in their shoes and take care of that Timothy. You will need the grace of God in your life. And to greet one another, and to love one another, and to be affectionate towards one another, and to embrace one another, and to care for one another, and to be kind to one another. A brethren greeting the brethren, caring for one another, taking care of the leadership and taking care of the members of the church. We need the grace of God. And then for you to receive greetings and affection from other believers in other places, and to accept them without any discrimination, it takes the grace of God. That grace is available. Call upon the Lord. The grace of the Lord is sufficient in your life. In our families, we need the grace of God. In our work, we need the grace of God. In our Christian lives, we need the grace of God. That grace is abundant, it's available. That grace will be with you. It will sustain you and see you through till the very end.